Thank you, everyone, for listening to Soul Talk with host Jeremy McDonald, the author of Peace Be Still. You can check out more about our shows or about Jeremy at soultalkradio.org and jeremymcdonald.net. And now for our show.
Hello, everybody, and thank you for listening to Soul Talk on Saturday. We got a great few guests here coming on. They're going to be on shortly. They were on another show, and I'm sure we'll be transitioning on here within the next minute or so. We're going to be talking about their book, Lessons in Courage, Peruvian Shamanic Wisdom for Everyday Life. And our guests are Bonnie Glass-Coffin. She has wrote several books and studied the Peruvian shamanic ways for many, many years. And Don Oscar Miro-Quesada. And it's interesting. I'm going to talk a little bit more about this when they get on the show. But the synchronicity that happened when I read their book back in November is I'm actually putting on an event here, and here they are actually coming on the line right now, so I'm going to bring them on, and just bear with me 1 second. Hello, and welcome to the show.
Thank you. Salutations, Jeremy.
How are you today?
Doing very well. This is Oscar Miro-Quesada, and I trusted Bonnie will be online as well.
Yeah, she hasn't come on yet. I was just actually getting ready to tell a story, waiting for you guys to come on. And it's kind of exciting because I read your book back in November, and I'm putting on an event here in my area in Florida. And the gentleman that I'm putting on the event with has taken your classes before. So when I mentioned you, I'm super excited.
And,
he owns his home, lives on a place called Sacred Lands in St. Petersburg, and he got over pretty excited that you were going to be on the show, so I just thought I'd share that with you.
Fantastic. Synchronicities abound when the medicine is supposed to be shared.
Absolutely. And Bonnie's right here. We're going to bring her on. Hello, Bonnie. Welcome to Soul Talk.
Hi, how are you?
Hello. I'm wonderful. How are you?
Good.
So we're just talking about it. Sorry, so what's that?
No, I was just saying hello in Spanish to my co-author. Hello, hola, Wilcañao, linda, ¿cómo estás? Can Bonnie hear me as well?
Bonnie, can you hear us?
Yeah, I can hear you.
Okay, we're just trying to make sure because it was faint back there. He was saying hello. Well, I just wanted to welcome you guys to the show, and everybody, thank you for listening to Soul Talk. I was just going to explain that I read your guys' book in November, and there are books out there, and we're definitely going to get into the meat of it, but there are books out there that I've read. I've read several over the past 20 years of my study. And this one, there's certain ones that you feel, and this is one of them that the energy off of it just resonates. And so I just want to give my hats off to you guys for the beautiful work that you've done here. Just going into the stories of that we have, but in here I want to go into that. But how did you guys kind of get started on this path of doing this this book? And you know, maybe you could do a little bit of a rundown of how you guys met and how that happened.
Certainly. Shall we? Are we on air now? Or is this being recorded?
We are on air.
Oh, wonderful. Well, I'm going to defer to my beloved sister and ally of the great work, Dr. Bonnie Glass-Coffin, to begin this little sharing of the history behind our coming together to co-create this offering of spiritual substance to the world, and also of a gift of shamanic research, which is so needed in these troubled times. So, Bonnie, if you'd like to go ahead and take the lead with answering that question, that would be wonderful. Thank you.
I think she lost her call, so I'm going to wait for her to come back on the line for that. So maybe,
okay, well, then I guess I'll go ahead and proceed and pay attention. Well, as you well know, Jeremy, with all labors of love that are intended to be a true gift, a presence that must be unwrapped from the muddled interpretation and history of the past. Our coming together was inspired by service, by a desire to teach love by the way we live through our example. And fortunately enough, we both brought to this purpose extensive experience in both in the shamanic fields as well as in medical anthropology, cultural anthropology, psychology, and other more Western academic traditions. So that marriage of mind and heart was at the soul, at the root of that bridging of worlds that allowed us to collaborate. I had been teaching cross-cultural shamanic arts for many, many moons and founded the Heart of the Healer Alliance, which is dedicated to safeguarding these ancestral healing traditions and earth-honoring ceremonies. And we used to have international gatherings yearly. And in our fifth international gathering, I contacted Bonnie to be a keynote speaker because of her vast expertise in female Peruvian folk healers, curandero. And she is the world's leading expert in female folk healers from the northern coast of Peru. And that's how we met. And if she's on the line now, I'm going to allow her to compliment what I've already said as an opening.
Yeah, she's not.
Not, okay. Well,
I'm going to open up the energy.
Very well, so I'll just continue. So at this international gathering, we had spoken over the phone, and I had read her book, The Gift of Life, and I had recommended it as a reading in my coursework, my apprentices, and hence felt a bonding and a resonance with who she was and what she was trying to do within academia. And this was her first time invited to participate as a ceremonialist as well as a speaker, and was, as you may have noticed in reading the book in November, that she said in the opening in her preface, she speaks about that destined encounter and how when she walked into the ceremonial ground that had been configured at the conference center, she was transformed by its beauty, by its aesthetic resilience and its graceful configuration and patterning of many of the philosophies and visionary understandings of our ancestral Andean peoples. Because when we create these ceremonial grounds, they are a mirror of all the cosmologies, of all of the stories of origin and of creation of the ancestral peoples of the Andes coast and Amazon of Peru. And she saw that this was reflected in this patterning of the ceremonial ground. And not that she hadn't been around mesas or healing altars before in her field studies and work, had experienced that at a very deep level, yet had never given herself the permission to be a practitioner of these arts. And when I saw her skill at being able to take this in at a visceral level and participate with the living soul of tradition rather than just being a scholar, I knew that she was going to be pivotal in disseminating and sharing this very important work with the wider audience. And I came prepared with a quill made out of a condor tail feather with a silver tip to it, and ritualized handing over of this quill to her in public during that gathering, and created what we call a compacto, an oath, an agreement that she would be the scribe of my personal narrative, of my story of how I came to be an instrument of love and healing present sometimes, and that's what lessons encourage. Peruvian shamanic wisdom for everyday life is the result of. I hope this provides you with an answer to your question, Jeremy.
It does, and the reason why I want to share something with you is that I read this, and I've had this. The reason why I mentioned the energy about the book is because this particular book, reading your lessons in courage, and some of the things that you talk about. I mean, they're different things that happen to you, but I was your steps of understanding yourself, even down to when you were a young boy and you were sick, and the light beings came to you, and that kind of stuff. And then you just knew that for a long, long time you were here to do something special, and your teachers that taught you that and taught you how to do that. Even down to, I think there's a part where you you have another, what they would call, what Raymond Moody would consider a near-death experience, where another angel came to you after you had a car accident. And I just, the thought process that I read when you're going through all of this, I think all of us have, you know, a struggle going on inside of us. And the way you learned and grew from it each time and understood yourself, and something just changed in you, and then the worries shed away, and those feelings shed away. And what happened about me reading this book, and I've interviewed a lot of people and read a lot of books, is that it gave me the courage to put on this event I'm putting on at Sacred Lands in St. Petersburg. And I finally just stepped up and said, I've been talking about this for 5 years, I'm doing it. And that's when the synchronicity happened, when I met Eric and he told me that he knew you, he was taking your classes before. And so why I was pretty excited about having both of you on the show, because I think everybody needs to hear about this, because this is about your life, but about the courage you found. And, and so,
well,
I mean, even down to...
Go ahead.
No, sorry.
No, that's fine. Even down to... Hello?
Oh, I was getting ready to say, I was talking about when you were a young boy, and I was almost smiling because you're going surfing, and you want to be with your teacher. and your teacher can just recognize where you're at, but he just loves you so much. And even your second teacher, about the process you went to make having him be your teacher, you feel like he almost knew what he was doing to you. And even down to, there's just a tremendous amount that's happening here that I just watch and I go, how many people are out there having this experience in their life? And if they would let go and learn along the process and have those 20 seconds of courage each step like you did, it would find the path.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Well, in dialogue with you, first of all, I'd like to say how deeply rewarding it is to hear that the book had such a positive impact on your own remembering. You're remembering, you're coming back into membership with a much wider family of seekers as well as awakened ones. For my teachers that aptly you've expressed almost knew what was coming down the pike even before I got there, people that have surrendered their ego sufficiently and welcomed the dark night of the soul as a crucible upon which the spirit can be forged, come out the other end, just like a near-death experience, transformed, renewed in vision, and with a deep sense of blissful peace that all is exactly the way it needs to be, without the old fear-motivated impulse to seek approval or control the circumstances of one's life. Life becomes a dance. It becomes a participatory dream more than a struggle, more than a task, if I make myself clear. And Hence, when I hear someone who's been touched by the book, such as yourself, that now goes out and is going to facilitate a spiritual or sacred gathering, like you've mentioned, and then connects with somebody who's been part of this tradition, part of this Pachakuti Mesa tradition, and the family, that wider pool of participants, the Auriakatena, which we call the golden chain of initiates, starts to show up in one's life, such as it did for you. And it provides an extraordinarily important validation that there are forces and powers and intelligences orchestrating our earthwork that are way beyond what our cognitive apperception can appreciate, and that they are constantly with it. They are the angels. They are the shining ones. They are those that show up to greet you when you do have a near-death experience and to hold your hand upon your return from other worlds. They are the ones constantly present. At times, both of bliss and of darkness. All we need to do is quiet ourselves enough, still ourselves a bit more, and open to your participation in our lives for this to become a truly creative dance of universal becoming. That's what the soul is about. And I do wish my beloved Bonnie would be online so that she can contribute her take on this.
Yet, yeah, I don't know what happened with that.
Is there any particular story in the book, event that you read about that you would like me to expand upon, or any questions you may have, Jeremy?
Well, I was there's a few of them. One of them is the biggest one I that comes to memory is the one where you're driving through, and forgive me if I mispronounce the name of the city, but I think it's Lima or Peru.
Yeah.
Yes. You're driving through, and I think there was martial law happening. They had to argue.
Yes.
You weren't supposed to be out. There was a curfew or whatever. And you were driving,
yes.
And you were upset. You were upset with God, I believe, is how you described it. And,
exactly.
And then you had a car accident. You flew almost. It sounded like to me that you went off a cliff or a place where there was construction, and and you basically died. You know, an angel came to you. What was that? I mean, obviously, that some would consider that a near-death experience. I think in the book you describe that this is the pinnacle point where things shed away. I was just going to say, how did that begin? Did it just immediately go away, or did you go on a journey from that point? Or?
Yeah, no, it was. After that, it took about 2 years for me to finally realize that I did not have to figure out whether I was dead or alive. But either way, I still had to get up and go to work in the morning, so I might as well make the best of it. But it was 2 years of struggle. So it didn't happen overnight, yet that near-death experience that resulted from that incident in the car that you mentioned occurred when I turned 33 years old, and I was in a very, very dark place in my life. Profound, sense of failure and low self-esteem, and having had to leave my year-and-a-half-old daughter in the United States with a very emotionally unstable mother, because I needed to return to Peru to fulfill my obligations as a Organization of American States fellow in ethnopsychology. So I had to pay back my scholarship working for the public health system there. And I just did not feel like, and I found myself living back at my mother's home at that age. And I did not feel like I was truly fulfilling my purpose on this planet. And I was in constant argument with Creator, with One Source, with, the great originating mystery, God, Goddess, whatever appellation you want to attribute to this much wider pool of wisdom that is, you know, permeates living universe. I was always wanting to challenge and, you know, prove to myself, and it was coming from a place of ego, of course, prove to myself that, you know, I was worthy of being revealed the great mysteries of being provided glimpses into the true secrets of creation. And it wasn't coming, and because I was forcing it. And at that point, due to my own poor, unhealthy choices, as is elaborated in the book, I decided to test God and see if God really existed. So I went out in the middle of martial law, which was curfew at the time during the military coup in 1980, and drove down streets that were abandoned by the coastal highway known as La Costa Verde, which, you know, borders Lima and the district of Miraflores, and just floored the gas pedal, took my hands off the steering wheel, and, you know, crying profusely, said, you know, Creator, if you exist, here I am, you know, and the car started to drive itself. And not only did it start to drive itself, it started to turn very sharp curves, and the street lights, every street light that I passed by would go off, and everything started to get dark, and I found myself going back up to the very part of the coast. It's much like in California, where you have these cliffs that go straight down to the ocean there. And then circled around and was heading toward a barrier that said, you know, forbidden, drop, stop. Just kept on going, and boom, then I flashed, I blacked out. And I found myself, as it's articulated in the book, in another neighborhood that was, you know, about seven blocks down from where this drop-off was, the cliff. The car was totally, and I was bleeding profusely. I still have the scars on my forehead to remind me of that episode. And it was the neighborhood was a typical Lima neighborhood, which is the capital of Peru, yet so brightly illuminated with light that it seemed almost like a movie set, you know, with all the bright lights. And I could hear the laughing of children, like playing. And when I came to, realized I was in this alternate reality that was not too different from what my conditioned mind could handle, that I was on the other side, really. And hence that being that looked like a very slick Peruvian Hispanic James Dean with a leather jacket with an FTP oil sign on it came walking to me, and we engaged in that telepathic communication regarding what I wanted to do with my life, and was given an option to continue on my journey to meet my maker or return and be of service to my daughter and the world as a whole. And I chose the latter, due to many reasons, also detailed in the book, and hence started my journey of recovery and of, you know, complete service to the spiritual awakening of other brothers and sisters on this planet, which I do at present in my healing work and teaching work. Mm. I hope that answers your questions.
It's beautiful. I mean, what's interesting is there's many I found with near-death experiences, or these experiences where they get a choice to come back. And when they come back, there is a purpose that they come back with, and it changes their life. Because, you know, I think how many people are out there that feel like they don't have a purpose, or they think that they have a purpose, or they feel it, but they don't know what to do with it. So I think that's really, really a great experience. So... So what initially, you had kind of a rough childhood in a sense because you were sick and there was problems at home, you know, what's going on with your mother and then your father mm-hmm. and that kind of stuff. And then mm-hmm. your father was pretty high up in the government of Peru mm-hmm. as well. Could we talk a little bit about that? Because I'm sure that there's plenty of people out there that are looking to get to your place, and they've had that past, but you let go of the past, and you can tell, at least to me, in your energy, that you feel you've let go of the past, and now you're living in the present, and you're helping the planet. So how does one do that? I mean, was it this near-death experience, or this experience, or was it just a series of things that helped you let go?
Well, if I can paraphrase, I hear you asking me about my personal journey that began as a child in Peru, that was challenged by not only physical limitations due to severe asthma, but also a quite rampant family dysfunction, emotional, psychological dysfunction. That's how I rose above that. I believe that that's what you're hinting at, because
right.
yes, that's pretty much most people's lives have an element of that. We're all either on a hero or heroine's journey from an archetypically speaking, we are here to fulfill that journey of discovery and of liberation. So my story is no different than others, although it may seem that way, because, you know, the form may be different, but the actual impulse of each individual human soul to refine themselves in purpose is there at all times. And that we not pay attention to yearning to that call, that vocation, that calling, becomes very, very difficult. And it usually involves great disappointment and struggle and suffering. Yet all of this is compost. All of this is fertile ground for us to grow. And my own story was my father worked for the public health institutes of Peru. And so he was stationed in very remote rural areas. So my first, from age 1.5 to age 4, I lived in very remote areas and in close proximity with indigenous or native communities of Peru, both in the Amazon and the highlands and in the coast. So my early exposure and identification with reality was that more of a mythic, more of a soul-infused world rather than the analytical, fact, data-based world that modern society is more attached to. So when I returned from being in my most early formative years exposed to this, you know, rich mythic reality of our indigenous peoples, I felt totally out of place. So the disconnect in my life began very early on. But then I returned to the capital of Peru, to Lima, and found myself in a world that I could not identify with. And hence, I started to constrict and close down even more, which in turn amplified my experience with difficulty breathing due to the asthma, combined with the high level of humidity in Lima. And all of this resulted in my eventually not being able to even breathe unless I was receiving dexamethasone or cortisone intravenously. And I was on the verge of death. So my father and mother decided to take me out of Lima to a place called Chosica, which is in the central highlands at around 11,000 to 12,000 feet in altitude, where I had that encounter with the three shining ones that is described in the book that resulted in the removal of the asthmatic condition. and that occurred when I was 10 years old. So that was my second near-death experience. My first occurred due to an electrocution when I was a year and a half. And then I had another one at age 10, as described in the book, and then the last one at age 33 when I was in a car accident with you, 13. So all these pivotal moments were rites of passage, were initiations into being ever more surrendered as a passerby, to borrow a phrase from the Sermon on the Mount, as somebody who walked through this earth without need to become attached to its form, and hopefully will leave very light footprints upon the earth as well.
Wow. Thank you. Thank you for that. So I think I'm feeling like we should change directions a little bit. I want to stick somewhat with your stories about your life, but there was a message that the shining ones, or you felt like you needed a message, and they wanted you, and I believe your teacher had a vision where he saw you going to the United States and going to back to North America. So there's a message that you're here to bring, and that's healing. And that I'm sure that has to do with the Heart of the Healer, organization you've come up with and stuff. So what is that message, that we're, you're teaching here? Obviously it's healing and understanding and stillness, but is there anything mm-hmm. that...
Certainly. Well, as narrated in the book, the last message I received once the three shining ones when I was age 10 conveyed or transmitted to me was remember the rituals. So that stayed with me. And hence from age 10 until I met my first mentor, Don Celso Rojas Palomino from Salas Chiclayo on that fateful surfing trip you referred to earlier, my life was very, focused on ritualizing everything. I started to realize that every time I could provide a ceremonial expression of my inner understanding of spirit, that it was a mirroring of creation. So when I would configure, for instance, a playground for my friends, I was doing it as a reflection of the playground in the heavens, in the stars. And over time, I realized that the as above, so below, as within, so without, as the self, so the world, is a process of mirroring, of correspondence. Regardless of scale, everything, all the patterns, cycles, the rhythm, the tonality, the breath that we experience in the natural world are being given ritual expression in our lives. And given that one learns to pay attention to these patterns that you observe in the natural world and mimic them in healing service, extraordinary, unlimited powers and forces are made available to the person who is an instrument of this reflection to be able to transform any stuckness, any impasse, any obstacle in the lives of others. And so therefore I developed what is known as the Pachakuti Mesa Tradition, which is a cross-cultural shamanic practice primarily derived from the northern coastal kamasqa curanderismo tradition of my first mentor, Don Celso, and also in combination with the southeastern highland Takokuna tradition, which focuses more on doing ceremonial feedings, ritual a nourishing of the earth, establishing a relationship with the living earth, while the northern coastal tradition focuses more on direct healing service to individuals and to human communities. So bridging together the shamanic arts that provide a restoration of wholeness, balance, and equilibrium to the lives of individuals and human communities with that of engaging the beauty and the grace of the natural world evolved into this tradition called the Pachakuti Mesa Tradition. Pachakuti, Pacha world, Kuti reversal, world reversal or cosmic transformation. Like all healing involves change, involves helping people manage their growth, their individuation, their evolution. And it is replete of ancestral wisdoms and time-proven ceremonial practices that deepen one's understanding that there is much more to this good life we have been blessed with on planet Earth than just having socioeconomic security and other more worldly illusory aspirations. Because, you know, Jeremy, everything's on loan. We don't get to keep anything. We're just moving through. And being an example of that through the practice of the Pachakuti Mesa tradition has helped people from, you know, all walks of life feel part of a sacred community, a sacred earth-honoring community, and understand that the prophecies of our ancient ones are something to be heeded and paid attention to. And that's what we're doing through the Heart of the Healer Alliance. We are allowing the wisdom of our ancient peoples to be expressed in a contemporary, relevant, and culturally adaptive way to them in the modern world. We also have programs that restore the rainforest ecosystem in Peru, and based on permaculture and, you know, places of initiation to these higher shamanic arts. I hope I'm making myself clear.
You are. And it's beautiful because I really feel, especially this year, things have been building into this for many years, but there's something I felt in 2014 where I just feel like people are changing. And the healing work that I've done for many years and that you've done for many years, and I see the healers, the elders that you have many years on me, have been doing for many, many years. I see a shift, it doesn't seem like it if you just look at it on the three-dimensional eyes, but if you feel it, you can feel a shift happening within the planet. And so the work that you're doing, to me, is changing the world and changing the environment around us just by being an example. So and being that mirror for people of what life can be like. So with rituals and traditions, I had actually been the one that would almost poo-poo it and some up to about 4 or 5 years ago, and then I realized, wait a second, I'm doing rituals. I've been doing rituals, it was only because I didn't understand them that I wasn't doing them. But when I sit on my couch and I start breathing a certain way, and I have to have my incense and my candles sitting a certain way, and I have a divine feminine and a divine masculine altar in my house, and that's ritual.
It certainly is. Life is ritual. Yeah, we have this notion in the Pachakuti Mesa tradition that corresponds to the five directions of the healing altar that we use. And so we understand that consciousness begets matter, meaning that, you know, awareness is a priori. It exists before the material form, the material world, right? So consciousness begets matter. Language begets reality. The words we use really, you know, inform the world we live in. You know? And then ritual begets relationship, because all relationships are based on ritual gestures of either reciprocity or, you know, equivalence or invitation to participate, but they're all ritualized. And therefore, all relationships have a ritual component to it, whether they are between humans or between an individual and their maker. And that's what you're saying. You know, when you bring in the patterning of your healing space where you work for the balance of the male and the female, you are fusing this dichotomy that is so prevalent in the world, you know, that separation, that sense of opposition. You're creating a non-dual space for the power of the marriage of all opposites to propel your intention as a healer forward at much deeper levels of restoring wholeness that would be otherwise positive. So, yes, you are a ritualist in your own right, and everybody does have a ritual they do. Eventually, we'll all be in one large, unified field of transformation and beauty on this planet. We're almost out of the Kali Yuga, of the Aukapacha, of the age of chaos, and we're moving into a return of the Satya Yuga, of the golden age, Koripacha, age of light. Yet it's all cycles, and we must learn to navigate those moments when it's time for darkness, just as efficiently as the times when it's about the light, without judging one or the other as better or more than its counterpart. These are the great secrets of the old. And so therefore, nature begets purpose and love begets life. Those are the five principles. Consciousness begets matter. Language begets reality, ritual begets relationship, nature, the natural world, begets purpose, and love begets life. However you understand that, and however you're listening, is able to take these principles in, good medicine, good nourishment for our planetary evolution.
Very interesting. Very, very great. Because the rituals basically give the some people call it the monkey mind. It gives it a process, and it's a relationship. Absolutely. Because I think when I was at my place where I wasn't looking at rituals, even though I was doing them, I wasn't honoring that part of myself that needed the ritual. So I wasn't having the relationship with it. And when I started having the relationship with it, then my peace started to happen, you know, because I started coming to balance with it.
Very simply, you mentioned, you know, a little moment ago, breath alone, like, to working the field of the Pachakuti Mesa as a shamanic healing altar ground, it always begins with the breath. And through the breath, we learn to engage a state of communion, of merging, of resonance with all that is. And from that place of communion, an experience of gratitude surfaces. But that experience of communion necessarily must begin with one's breath. We understand in shamanic traditions of Peru that the soul, consciousness, enters through the soft spot on the baby's head the minute the baby has their first breath. That's not to say that the organism is alive and has vitality and is spirited and it's a living being, yet it's not fully self-aware until the breath comes in. And the breath is fundamental as the beginning and the initiator of a self-aware, sentient experience as a human. So once you can enter into communion with that understanding through your breath and you feel that you are part of the great web of life, a very natural sense of gratitude surfaces in the heart. At that point, we do a consecration, which is an offering of tobacco, of coca leaves, of cornmeal, of pollen, of incense, of whatever, you know, sweet nourishment that the sacred enjoy. You know, a gesture of thanksgiving recommended. That's a very simple ritual. Enter into communion, offer a consecration. At that point, you can configure or compose your life by setting up a little altar now. Then through your songs, your rattling, your prayers, your toning of sacred mantralizations or sacred words that have been used since time immemorial, You connect with the shamanic universe that's mostly unseen, and then cooperation is possible. And at that point, then you do service. But those are the five C's of Pachakuti Mesa tradition ceremony: commune, consecrate, compose, connect, cooperate. And there's very simple tools and techniques in the book that teach you how to enact these ritual processes for the renewal of your own personal wholeness and also the restoration of wholeness on a planetary level in the world. So, yes, practice does help.
It certainly does. And we everything is a practice. I realize one day I'm just down here practicing and experiencing and enjoying it for what it is and loving it at every moment. So, and even in my rituals I'm practicing. I was just sitting here processing because you were talking about the Golden Age earlier, and you know, and some would refer to that as the Age of Aquarius or you know, we're coming into that new light. And then the study I've been going into recently is about breath and stuff like that and breathing. And I realized that, wait a second, every time I breathe and set my intention, I'm breathing new life into this new era. And, you know, kind of like, you know, it talks about when I and God breathed life into Adam and Eve in the Bible. And I was like, whoa, wait a second. So the breath is what I breathe into my intentions so that I can go into flow with the cosmos. And I don't know where that all came from, but it came from spirit, I guess. And it's interesting how that golden age is really starting to open people up and become have them aware. So it's very good stuff. We actually have a caller. I'm gonna bring them on the line and spirit.
Please.
One second. Hello, caller from a 509 area code. Hello?
Oh my goodness, hello. I didn't press one, but that's okay. I just, I'm brand spanking new to your show, and hi.
Oh, hi, did you have a question for Miro-Quesada?
I don't at this moment. I just caught wind of you through Facebook, and I thought I'd give a listen.
Oh,
and I thank
well,
you.
I will. You're welcome, and I'll put you back on. Thank you for listening.
Thank you.
Thanks for listening.
So we're
there,
kind of
there. It is. There's an example of how spirit is already doing its magic, one soul at a time.
Absolutely. I'm really enjoying this connection with us because the building of energy and. The space that's bringing in, because you know, we talk about our books, and we're talking about your book, Lessons in Courage, and the energy in your path. But the energy, it seems like, that we're going to build here is just healing. And for every other radio show and workshop that you teach around the country, it builds an energy, and people feel that, and spirit brings them in to help them and to help us. I just think that's very beautiful. So,
yes, sir, Bob. The age of Aquarius is a reality, and not only from a point of view of the understanding of astrology based on our current zodiac, yet from a point of view of cosmic eras, of the equinoctial procession, and how we are moving, the axis of our of Gaia, of our planet Earth, is in fact very soon going to be directed to the galactic center, and hence Ursa Minoris, or the North Star, will no longer be that sixth true north in the sky, but the Pleiades will be. And at the opposite end, there'll be the Southern Cross. So the connection between the Earth axis, as the equinoctial procession completes its passage through the ecliptic, and now is, you know, directly aligned with the galactic center, with the monastic sun, called in Theosophy, is going to usher in an inordinate amount of transformative soul evolutionary possibility on planet. And people who are not able to allow it into their lives are going to feel great disturbance and are going to feel crisis and emotional honors rather than an opportunity to propel themselves beyond their self-absorbed interests. That's a great transformation. That is what is then hinted at through the prophecies of our ancients since time immemorial, including the Mayan prophecies. They are not, you know, unique events. They happened many times over, every 25,920 years on this planet. There's a full ecological procession, which brings with it a new birth at the planetary level. And the first people, the first beings to heal that are self-reflexive species, such as humans, that are aware of themselves. The animal kingdom, the plant kingdom, the mineral kingdom, they all know that they are not separate from the great turnings, from the great shifts. And they know where to go and where to be. Humans still need a little waking up, and the waking up is coming down.
You know, it's funny you should say that. I have two beautiful dogs. One is a white shepherd, and I call her Shaman Dog for a very specific reason. And I have a Rottweiler when I do shows, they lay down and go to sleep when I'm on a show, and the Rottweiler is usually very energetic, almost to the point where when I teach classes out of my home, he can't be in the room because he would be trying to be up on everybody because he's just so loving and caring. The one I refer to as Shaman Dog, which was my mother's dog, and my mother was trained in the Mayan shamanism traditions, and we referred to her as that is because when my mother would do table work, Molly, the dog, would get up on her hind legs and put her paws on the person with the other healers.
Oh, how wonderful.
Yes, and so when I teach classes, now she's about 11 years old now. When I teach classes, uh-huh. My mother has since passed away, and now she's become my dog. The person that needs the most energy work, she will literally, from a sleep state, wake up, point her nose towards them, and about that time, that person's raising their hand to ask a question. And so I just really pay attention to her and my dogs because they know on a level that even where I'm in a very quiet state, they're seeing things that I'm not seeing, and I just really pay attention to what they're telling me.
That's very wise, Jeremy. I have the same experience with our little furry ones here, and also throughout the natural world, all it takes is to still yourself and observe, quiet the mind a little bit, because as you say, Molly the shaman dog is really a spirit's compass. It's just like a compass. If you observe the sensitivity, the extreme sensitivity of all of our animal relatives to the fluctuations in the geomagnetic field of the planet, that combined with what they can sense in terms of a two-legged of health or being, makes them exquisite instruments to guide our actions by. You know, they are truly being guided by a higher power without needing to filter that higher power into consciousness. But they're all heartbeats. So, yeah, we will return to the place where we will walk hand in hand with our animal relatives, our plant relatives, our stone relatives, and our star relatives. This is coming.
Wonderful. I am looking forward to it with all of my heart, and I can feel it, in my heart. And the more and more I open up in my heart, and I know other people around me, the more and more they open up their heart, they can feel, and I think that's wonderful. And believe it or not, we're down to 3 minutes. I'm not sure what happened to Dr. Glass-Coffin, but I'm sure that I will have you both back on the show at some time. But is there any last things that you wanted to talk about that maybe I didn't kind of cover in the last couple of minutes here?
Well, first of all, I want to express my gratitude for opening up the safe, sacred dialogue. Every radio interview is different. And I enjoyed the open-ended, expansive field that you provided for me to explore my own story in a way that doesn't have to just be, a repetition of what is in Lessons in Courage, but speaking from my own heart. So that's very refreshing. Thank you, Jeremy. And I do want to encourage your listening audience, if you're interested in apprenticing in the Pachakuti Mesa tradition, cross-cultural shamanism, that they go to www.heartofthehealer.org. That's all one word, heartofthehealer.org. There you can find opportunities. If this conversation is inspired you to learn more, opportunities to deepen your shamanic practice and to expand your healing service on planet. And also, of course, I would deeply appreciate anybody listening to this to buy our book, Lessons in Courage, Peruvian Shamanic Wisdom for Everyday Life. You can purchase it on Amazon.com and at your local bookstore, I trust. And just pass it forward. Thank you so much for your support for the human service that you provide on this earth. Thank you, Jeremy, so much for having me on.
You're most welcome, and I look forward to future interactions and blessings. Thank you so much.
This is wonderful. And if you like the book, Jeremy, your any review would be deeply, deeply appreciated on Amazon. It'll help.
I definitely will. Thank you so much.
And looking Bye-bye. Forward to meeting you sometime. Is this Eric Paiva you're talking about?
Yeah, the owner of Sacred Lands in St. Petersburg, where the Tocoboga Indians village, his house is built on that. So
fantastic. Please give Eric a big, big hug on my behalf when you see him, and best of luck with your St. Petersburg.
Well, real quick, I wanted to let you know, Sarah and I are looking, and I don't want to give a whole lot of details on air, but we're looking at maybe booking a workshop for you there. So,
John, tell me when. Tell me when, brother. That would be wonderful.
I definitely will.
I'd be honored.
And I will talk to you soon.
Much love. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Thank you guys for listening, and you all have a wonderful, wonderful day. Bye-bye.